2017 year, it's still our 16-17 season for the Keyano College Lecture Series. Just a couple comments before I start. I'll introduce our next talk, and then I'll get down to business with this one. So, if you enjoy this one, and I'm pretty sure you will, please join us on February 24th back here to find out about air travel. Dr. Hugh Gordon, our history instructor, is going to speak on from Concords to Airbuses, or why air travel is no longer fun. Gone are the days of champagne and caviar, I think. Anyway, tonight we're here for a talk by Jane Jakes, the once and future king, the appeal of King Arthur. If you're like me, you might be a fan of King Arthur legends. I always enjoy a good hero story, all the trials and tribulations. But Jane Jakes, she's been at Keyano College with us for 27 years. And during that time, she's developed our university studies, English courses in folklore, in the history of children's literature, and in the literature of King Arthur. She's also the managing editor of Northward, the literary journal of Canada's North, and is currently accepting submissions for issue 17, all you budding writers out there, with the theme of dystopia. The deadline for that submission is March 30th, and if you're interested at all, please speak with Jane. Jane hopes you enjoy tonight's journey to Camelot and beyond. So join me in giving Jane a warm welcome.
What do you think of when the words King Arthur are spoken? Well, depending upon your age, your interests, or your familiarity with cultural events, you might have an image like this in mind, of Mel Farrar in the 1954 film, The Knights of the Round Table. Or you might think of this fellow, Nigel Terry, in Excalibur from 1981. Or Clive Owen from the film King Arthur in 2004. Or perhaps you think about Graham Chapman, 1975, in the Monty Python and the Quest of the Holy Grail. Or perhaps you think about The Sword in the Stone, or Camelot, or the Round Table, or the Holy Grail. When I teach the literature of King Arthur, I generally start by asking my students to name all of the themes, characters, ideas, and events that are associated with the Arthurian legends. And within a few moments, we have the boards covered, because these stories are wide-ranging and all-encompassing. They've taken elements from tales all over and added them to the Arthurian legends. And these tales also spread across the globe. Here's a picture of the arch of a church in Modena, Italy. It's from the 12th century, and the carvings show images from the tale, the Knight of the Cart, a Lancelot story. So even in Italy, it was a very familiar tale. The monk Alanus in the 12th century put it best. He said, "Whither has not flying fame spread and familiarized the name of Arthur the Briton, even as far as the empire of Christendom extends? Who does not speak of Arthur the Briton, since he is almost better known to the peoples of Asia Minor than to the Welsh and Cornish?" Even in this period, the stories of King Arthur had spread across Europe and into Asia Minor, the Crusaders taking the tales there. The tales have gone far afield. And we will see tonight that the tales encompass every sort of genre as well, from saints' legends in the 7th century to medieval histories and medieval romances to 19th century poetry, into the 20th century, where we have video games, cartoons, comic books, movies, television shows, children's novels, and on and on. Nor does it stop here. In May of 2017, a new film is coming, King Arthur, Legend of the Sword, directed by Guy Ritchie and starring Jude Law and Charlie Hunnam. A commentator on IMDb, the International Movie Database, said, "Do we really need another King Arthur story?" And the answer, of course, is, well, yes, in fact, we do. Because these tales are endless. They can be told and retold over and over and over. And with each retelling, new elements are added, new layers to the tale. This evening, I want to talk about why the tales retain their popularity. Why is it that we continue to be interested in the stories of a noble but flawed king, and his loyal and treacherous followers, and his loving but faithless wife? What is it that keeps us returning to these legends? I want to start off by placing Arthurian tales in an historical context to see where they come from, and I'll speak a bit about the quest for the historical Arthur. Then we'll look at some of the genres of tales that have been told, and then we'll return to this question of why Arthur continues to hold appeal. When we speak of the past of Arthur, the history, we go to the year 43 as a place to begin. This is when the Roman Empire is holding sway across Europe, Northern Africa, and into the Near East. The Roman Empire is powerful. It's an amazing bureaucracy, well organized. There are roads, there's indoor plumbing, and there's the Roman Legion, one of the best trained forces in the world. But it's not the only empire. There's also empires in China, Japan, and India that have a sophisticated culture and a set of well-established trade routes at this point. Mathematics, astronomy, and the calendar are all in forms that we would recognize today. In Egypt, at the Great Library of Alexandria, there are tens of thousands of volumes. It's a sophisticated, well-organized world. And what's happening on that little island up in the North Atlantic? Well, people are running around half naked, daubed with blue paint, and they're fighting in tribal warfare. By the 19th century, it would be said that the sun never sets on the British Empire, but at this point, the sun hasn't even risen. The people in Britain at this point are the Celts, and they have displaced the original, the indigenous people of that island, of whom we know virtually nothing. But the Celts are fierce, warlike people, but fairly small in stature and relatively few in number. And they're on an island that is rich with natural resources, just a stone's throw away from the powerful Roman Empire. Well, you know what happens next. In the year 43, Rome makes its assault on the island, and with relative ease, they take over. There are a few local revolts. One of them by the warrior queen Boudica, but the revolts are easily put down and Rome is now in charge of Britain. This is the first point at which stories of King Arthur are set. The writer Geoffrey of Monmouth, of whom we'll hear more later, sets his Arthur in the pre-Roman period. So Rome is now established in Britain, and Rome does what Rome always does. It takes control. It slaps its corporate logo on every flat surface. It paves the roads. There's indoor plumbing. And there's fantastic administration and organization and bureaucracy. And there's also the Roman Legion. The 6th Legion, the Victrix, is posted in Britain at this point. and very useful too, because it fends off invasions from the continent, from the Angles and Saxons and Jutes and Frisians, and also invasions from the island to the west, what we now know as Ireland. And the Romans settle in, they intermarry, and a Romano-Celtic culture is established for 400 years. But the Roman Empire is not going to last forever. There are cracks appearing in it. It's far-flung, it's hard to maintain. And the barbarians on the continent have horses, and the Roman legion, however well-trained, is still largely on foot. So in the year 407, Rome recalls its forces from Britain for the legion to come back and to fight for the Eternal City. And in the year 410, Rome falls, plunging Britain into chaos, because all of a sudden its administration, its organization, and perhaps most importantly, its security has been taken away, and it has to fight for its survival. A leader emerges in Britain, but he's a treacherous leader, Vortigern. And he makes a pact with the Angles. He says that they can move in and take over Essex and Kent in the south in exchange for protection against the other barbarian tribes. The painting here shows Vortigern greeting the Angle leaders, who are traditionally known as Hengist and Horsa. But they arrive and they betray Vortigern. They open the floodgates to the Saxons and the Jutes and the Frisians, and they come in their thousands, and the Romano-Celtic people are overwhelmed. This is the Dark Ages. And as historian David Day says, the civilization of Romano-Celtic Britain, its forts, citadels, temples, churches, libraries, and cities, was overrun, burned, and obliterated. Now, it's at a time like this that a hero is needed, and hero tales begin to emerge. And this is the second period when Arthurian tales are set, and this is when tales about King Arthur start to develop. The writer Jack White, the Canadian writer, sets his Eagle series about King Arthur in the post-Roman period. Now, there's some scattered evidence for the existence of an historical Arthur. And who might that historical Arthur have been? Well, there are several possibilities. One of them is named Ambrosius Aurelianus. He was described in early accounts as being the son of the last Roman governor of Britain. And the story had it that he stayed behind to help the Romano-Celtic people. Now, he, in later accounts, is given as being an uncle of King Arthur. And still later, he's associated with some stories about Merlin, and magic is brought in. So there's not very much to say about Ambrosius Aurelianus, except that his name comes up at the same time as that of Arthur. Another candidate is a Celtic warlord named Owen. And the story has it that he tried to unite his people and fight against the invaders, but then he was betrayed by one of his own men. Now, traditionally, Celtic warlords took the name of a powerful animal to show their own strength and power. Boadicea, for instance, that was not her name, that meant lioness. Pendragon was another example of this powerful name of an animal. It's possible that Owen took the name of Bear in order to make himself sound more powerful, taking the name from the Brythonic, which was the early form of Welsh, and from the Latin. The Brythonic word for bear was Arth. The Latin word for bear, Ursus. Put them together, Arthursus, Arthur. Is it possible that he united those two languages in his name, just as he was trying to unite the two groups of people? It's a possibility, but there's very little evidence. Or perhaps you like the idea of a Ukrainian Arthur. It's not absurd, because that 6th Legion, the 6th Roman Legion, was drawn largely from Sarmatian warriors who were from the Black Sea area of what is now Ukraine. And it's possible that when the Roman Legion was recalled in 407, that some of those Sarmatians, feeling more unity with the people of Britain, stayed behind to fight. That's the premise of the 2004 film, King Arthur, with Clive Owen, where the protagonist is Artoris Castus, a Sarmatian soldier. The idea of the Ukrainian Sarmatian Arthur is further bolstered by the knowledge of the battle standards that the Sarmatians had in the 6th Roman Legion. One of those battle standards had an image of a red dragon. And that's an image traditionally associated with Arthur, because it's also the image of Wales. But the other image, wait for it, was a sword in a stone. This is a Sarmatian sword with the characteristic ring pommel. And there are accounts of that image in or beside an anvil. And this was a shoulder patch and a flag for the Sarmatians. So we've got that sword in the stone, Arthur combination there. And another possibility for Arthur is mentioned in the writings of the monk Nennius in the 9th century. He talks about Arthur as a powerful leader who fought the Saxons and was victorious in 12 battles, culminating in a decisive victory at the Battle of Badon in the year 500. And he says that at that battle, 900 Saxons were killed, 460 of them at Arthur's own hand, because Nennius describes Arthur as a giant, and that he has a grave that's 12 feet long, and that he has a dog with a paw print like this, and the dog has stepped into a rock, and Nennius urges people to go and look at the rock, because that's evidence that Arthur's dog was there. So even though his book was called The History of Britain, we can't rely on Nennius as any kind of an historian. He's obviously creating a sort of fantasy or legend, and he's also writing some 400 years after the fact. So very little evidence for an historical Arthur, except for the fact that we have in royal genealogies at the end of the 6th century, the name of Arthur suddenly appears. It hadn't appeared before anywhere, but all of a sudden, in 6 separate genealogical tables, babies are being named Arthur. Now, why would that happen? The possibility is that people were naming their child after a hero, after some prominent figure, and the name Arthur comes up. It happens throughout history. In England, there weren't any children with the first name of Gordon until 1885, when General Gordon was successful, had heroic exploits. He was killed at Khartoum, and his exploits were in the papers. He was on everyone's lips, and suddenly people were naming their children Gordon. Similarly, in America in the 1940s and 50s, the name Dwight suddenly appeared. It had not been much used to that point, but all of a sudden, because of the victorious general and the president of the United States, Dwight D. Eisenhower, we see a rise in the use of the name Dwight. So the possibility is that Arthur was a real-life figure, and people chose to call their child Arthur after him. Now, why were people even looking for an historical Arthur? The fact is that Arthur has been used throughout the centuries to bolster the legitimacy of kings and other rulers. From William the Conqueror to Henry VIII, from French kings to Hitler. someone has always tried to trace the historical Arthur in order to be able to say, yes, I am the legitimate ruler here because I am related to Arthur in some spurious way. The other place we see Arthur in the earlier medieval period is in saints' tales, coming out of Wales in particular. And rather amusingly, Arthur takes the role in these stories of a villain, because the saint is the hero, so you have to have somebody opposing the saint, and it's Arthur. In this particular image, we see King Arthur on the left arguing with Saint Cadoc. Saint Cadoc gave shelter to a man who was accused of having killed three of Arthur's men. And Arthur is furious at this apparent betrayal of at the Christian hospitality and generosity of the saint. So he demands reparation. He says, you have to give me 3 head of cattle in reparation for the deaths of my men. Saint Cadoc does that, but when Arthur gets the cattle home, they turn into 3 bundles of ferns. So throughout the tales, Arthur is always overcome by the power and the saintliness, and he doesn't get his way. The next stage that we see of Arthur after scattered tales and fragments and chronicles is a rather important one. It's the work of Geoffrey of Monmouth. Now, he was the Bishop of Wales, which was a political position, so he had a political reason for writing about Arthur. He wrote The History of the Kings of Britain, wrote it in Latin, and he did that in order to bolster the claim of the Norman kings. And his history starts with the arrival of Brute, the escaped slave from Troy, who comes and founds the island of Britain, founds the community there, and it goes on through history. But Geoffrey spends about a third of the book on the tales of King Arthur, and he develops these quite thoroughly from the birth of Arthur through to the final battle. In his text, he also introduces Merlin. Merlin was a well-known figure in Welsh mythology, and Geoffrey of Monmouth was clearly interested in Merlin because he wrote a book of the prophecies of Merlin, he wrote the life of Merlin, so he grafts Merlin onto the Arthurian tales, and that becomes part of what's happening there. Geoffrey of Monmouth's work was extremely popular in its own time. In an era where everything was scripted by hand, there are still 200 copies extant of the History of the Kings of Britain. So there must have been hundreds of them produced. And we know his popularity because his work was plagiarized and copied and reformatted and translated. He was writing around the year 1137. And by 1155, a poet named Robert Wace had already translated Monmouth into French. And he presented it to the king and queen, Henry II and Eleanor of Aquitaine. This is the tomb of Henry II and Eleanor of Aquitaine. They're buried in an abbey in France because she was French and he was certainly closely associated with the French throne. And I love the detail that she's holding onto a book. Even in death, she can't put it down. Just one more chapter. It is in all likelihood a prayer book, but I like to think that she's reading Robert Wace's poem, Roman de Brute, and getting just one more glimpse of Arthur. Wace did more than just translate the stories. He reshaped them. He made Arthur into the ideal French king. He made a very elegant account of the court of King Arthur and the mannerly behavior and so on. And he also added his own twists to the story. He added psychological realism. And we can see this in comparing him with his source, Geoffrey of Monmouth. Both of them describe the conception of King Arthur. Arthur's father, Uther Pendragon, falls madly in love with Igraine. But the problem is, Igraine is a married woman. She's married to Gorlois, the Duke of Cornwall. And Gorlois has always been at odds with Uther. When he realizes that his wife is being courted by Uther, he becomes furious. He takes his wife to their castle at Tintagel, and this is the remains of that castle. It's on a spit of land at Cornwall, inaccessible. And he locks Igraine up in the castle, and then he goes to war with Uther. Uther, meanwhile, begs his wizard Merlin to give him a potion so that he will transform his appearance and he will look exactly like Gorlois. So Gorlois is off at war. Uther goes to Tintagel, saunters past the guards because he looks exactly like Gorlois, goes in, finds Igraine, and makes love to her. And she thinks it's her husband, of course. At the very moment of conception, Gorlois on the battlefield is killed. So Arthur is not conceived in adultery. Fornication, yes. Adultery, no. Now, the way that Geoffrey of Monmouth and Robert Wace describe Uther's reaction to Gorlois' death tells us something about the tales. Geoffrey of Monmouth puts it like this. When Uther learned all that had happened, he mourned the death of Gorlois, but rejoiced that Igraine was freed from the bonds of marriage. Very straightforward. Wace says, Uther said that he was very disturbed by the Duke's death, since he had not wanted that. He mourned and regretted this deed, acting very angry toward those who had done it. He clearly assumed the appearance of a mourner, but very few of his men believed him. So Wace is adding something to the tale. He's adding psychological complexity. He's adding some irony. He's creating a new story out of the material that Geoffrey of Monmouth has provided. And we start to see that these tales are not about what they're about. They're about how they're about them. And every writer is going to be adding something to the tales. Wace added something else, the Round Table. Wace's poem, Romande Brut, has the first mention of the Round Table. This is the Round Table at Winchester in England. It's 18 feet in diameter, made of solid oak. It weighs 1.5 tons, and it's painted in alternating stripes of green and white with the names of the knights painted around it. And for centuries, this was thought to be the actual Round Table of King Arthur. But modern analysis has found that the wood was actually cut around the year 1250. So that's too late for Arthur, about 700 years too late. In fact, it was probably constructed to bolster the claims of the throne of Edward I. Wace wrote about it. Edward's men constructed it. The story by Monmouth in Latin and translated by Wace into French was translated again into English by a priest named Lawman. And he brought something else to the tales. Instead of having the fierce Roman fighting Arthur of Monmouth or the French king type Arthur of Wace, he makes Arthur the model of an Anglo-Saxon chieftain, and he has him fighting battles that are described much more fully than in either of the two sources, because Lawman is fascinated by the drama. So we've got a great deal of battle and fighting in Lawman's poem, and we also have a great deal of magic, because he seemed to like that side of the drama as well. Wace and Monmouth both downplay the magic aspects. Lawman plays it up. And the tales went across the channel, and the Arthur of French romance was born. In the Middle Ages, the genre of romance was the most popular And literally tens of thousands of pages were written in France by minstrels and balladeers telling the stories of Arthur and the men of his court and the chivalry and the mercy and the justice. These were all things that the French balladeers added to the stories. They also added the Holy Grail. The word Graal in Old French meant simply a dish. And in the first versions of the Holy Grail appearing in tales, it's a jeweled platter, and it holds a single communion wafer. The Fisher King has been wounded. He's had been stabbed in the thigh by a spear, the spear of Longinus, traditionally the spear that the Roman soldier stabbed Christ on the cross with. So Fisher King is mortally ill, and he can only be healed by having a communion wafer from this special platter every day. So the minstrels took this tale and added it to the stories of King Arthur. And then that platter morphed into a cup, and now it's the cup from which Christ drank at the Last Supper, and then it's the cup that Joseph of Arimathea uses to catch the blood of Christ from the cross. And the knights of King Arthur are visiting the Fisher King, and they see a vision of this cup and decide that they have to find it and follow it. So the quest of the Holy Grail is born. And this becomes yet another part of the Arthurian tales. Writing in France at the same time was Chrétien de Troyes, who was a court poet. He saw his work as much more sophisticated and elegant than that of the common writers, which it was. So he signed his work, which was quite unusual for a writer in the medieval period. And he added to the tale Percival. And Parsifal became an important figure, particularly in European retellings. So at each level, we see yet more coming in. It's like an archaeological dig to go through the Arthurian tales and to see, oh yes, this is where we have the Lady of the Lake first making an entrance. Here we have the arrival of Guinevere. Chrétien de Troyes also added Camelot as the home of King Arthur. At this point, the stories of Arthur were familiar across Europe. Everybody knew about Arthur, as Alanus said, who whither has not flying fame taken the name of Arthur. You could have taken an urchin off the street in Prague or Nuremberg or Istanbul and said, tell me a story about King Arthur. And the child would have been able to reel off a tale that would be recognizably Arthurian. But ironically, there was one place where Arthur was less well known by the year 1400, and that was England. But that was shortly to change. We have Thomas Malory. Thomas Malory was a knight, and he was a member of Parliament, and he was also a convicted felon who spent 20 years in prison. Now, why he was in prison, we're not too sure. It's possible that he was a political prisoner, because he was a Lancastrian at the time when the Yorks were in power during the Wars of the Roses. But the Yorks issued a general pardon for all political prisoners during this period, and Malory was specifically excluded from that pardon by name. So it could be that he was in prison because he was a bad dude. He had been convicted of manslaughter and robbery and rape. Why he was in prison, we're not too sure, but what he did there, we know. He gathered some of those tens of thousands of pages of French romance of King Arthur, and he proceeded to translate them. And again, did more than translate, he shaped them into a coherent narrative, starting with the conception of Arthur and carrying on to his death, as Geoffrey of Monmouth had done, but also adding the knights and their exploits and their backgrounds and stories that were connected, such as Tristram and Isolde, and he made a comprehensive book, which he called The Whole Book of King Arthur and His Noble Knights of the Round Table. And one of the things that Mallory added was Lancelot. Lancelot had existed in the French romances. He was depicted as Arthur's best friend, and he had a relationship with Guinevere that varied from being a chivalric one to one of more greater closeness. But in Mallory's version, Lancelot and Guinevere are lovers. As Mallory puts it, they loved more hotter with the times. And this destroys Lancelot. Three times in Mallory, he runs off into the forest. He goes mad because he can't stand the deception that he's perpetrating on his king. He is torn because he loves and honors King Arthur, but he also loves Guinevere. And every time he tries to leave Guinevere, she banishes him from the kingdom, and then she gets into trouble, and he has to come back to save her. So it's a very complex relationship, and Lancelot essentially becomes the protagonist of the book. Arthur is a colorless figure compared to Lancelot. It's quite clear that Mallory was most interested in the tale of Lancelot as it was. Mallory died in 1471, and this was just at the time when an invention was going to change the face of Europe and the whole concept of reading. And that invention, of course, was the printing press. William Caxton, a London merchant, traveled a good deal to Europe. He saw the printing press in action, he recognized its potential, and he brought it back to England. His first printing was of chapters of the Bible. And then, in 1485, he printed Mallory's book. And he may have been confused about the title. Instead of calling it the whole book of King Arthur and his noble knights, he took instead the title of the last section only, the section about the death, and he called the book The Mort d'Arthur. And that's how we continue to know it today. It was a tremendous success to Caxton's pleasure because he had foreseen it as being a problem. He thought there would be some reaction to these degenerate French stories coming into English. So he published a preface in which he defended his decision to print the stories of King Arthur. He spoke about Arthur as being the model for humanity. He spoke about him as being one of the nine worthies, three from the ancient world, three pagans, and three Christians, all of whom provided models for good behavior. And he finished his preface by saying, "For herein may be seen noble chivalry, courtesy, humanity, friendliness, hardiness, love, friendship, cowardice, murder, hate, virtue, and sin. Do after the good and leave the evil, and it shall bring you to good fame and renown." And the book was a great success. Everybody in England was reading Mallory, interested in Mallory, and it meant a revival of the customs and behavior that had fallen away. Tournaments were back into fashion after 1485, and there were round table societies that began, the nobles started, so that they could play at being King Arthur and his knights. Remember the Winchester Round Table? Well, this was the point at which Henry VII had a Tudor rose painted in the center. So once again, Arthur is in style. But nothing lasts forever, and even though Arthur trended for about 100 years, Arthur fell out of favor. And there might be a few reasons for that. For one thing, around the late 16th century, travel and exploration becomes the norm. New places are being discovered, and perhaps the stories about fairyland paled in comparison to actual travelers' tales, discovering South America, Australia, what's Camelot beside the Caribbean, and these travel tales became the popular reading, and the fantasy less so. And then, too, Arthur is very, very Catholic. There in Mallory, there are priests, there are nuns, there are hermits, there are holy relics to be venerated. There's the Holy Grail. And none of this sat very well with the increasingly Protestant England under Elizabeth I and her successors. And then, too, in Mallory, there's magic, there's enchantment, there are witches, there are wizards. And that, too, was not very popular with the Protestants, particularly the Puritan faction. We can see that Arthur has become less popular in the fact that a certain playwright never wrote about him. Shakespeare didn't write King Arthur stories. We have King Lear, we have Macbeth, King of Scotland, we have Henry IV and Henry V and Julius Caesar, but there's no King Arthur. In all of Shakespeare, there's only a single reference to King Arthur. It's in Henry IV, Part 2, where a character named Justice Shallow says, "I was Sir Dagonet in Arthur's show." Now, that reference tells us a couple of things. First, that Shakespeare knew his audience at that point would at least recognize the concept of Arthur's show. So in the late, the 1580s, 1590s, there were still shows of Arthur that were familiar to people. But Justice Shallow is an old man, and he's recalling something from his youth. So that line might indicate that Arthur's show is now passé. Plus, Sir Dagonet was a fool. He was Arthur's jester. And Justice Shallow is a foolish character. So there might be the implication that the Arthurian tales are not only passé, they're a little bit silly and forgotten. There's no indication that Shakespeare ever planned to write an Arthurian tragedy. But one can always hope that there's a lost one out there somewhere. So if you ever find the Shakespeare's Arthur when you're cleaning out your garage, I'd be happy to take it off your hands. Arthur came back into popularity with the revival of interest in the medieval period around 1750. It was the era of the Enlightenment, of logic and scientific reasoning. And Arthur is completely without those things and appealed to the sector of the population that wanted magic and mystery and the fantastical doings of the past. So the Gothic revival brings back such things as tournaments. Between 1750 and 1839, there were tournaments all over Europe again. Suddenly it's in style. It was tremendously expensive, but nonetheless popular. Something like a Wild West show, but with armor instead of buckskin. And it's no surprise that Mallory came back into print at this point. Mallory's Mort d'Arthur had been out of print since 1634, and the last edition then, the editor said that he'd removed all of the superstitious and profane speeches. But in 1817, Mallory's Mort d'Arthur was once more on the bookshelves. And so a whole new generation was reading the stories about King Arthur, and poets and writers and painters were inspired anew. One of those was Alfred Tennyson. He was born in 1809 and grew up reading that newly reprinted King Arthur. He recalled playing stories of Arthur with his brothers at their home in Somerset. As a young man, he wrote poetry based on Mallory. And then when he was appointed Poet Laureate of England in 1850, he embarked upon a massive project, the Great English Epic. 12 poems, lengthy poems, about the exploits of Arthur and his knights, based on Mallory, but drawing on his own imagination as well. And this was published as the Idylls of the King. In the Idylls of the King, we see Arthur as the ideal once more, but not the ideal medieval king, not the ideal French king. Now he's the ideal Victorian gentleman. He is depicted as noble, upright, honest, and cold as a dead fish. There's a scene in Idylls of the King where Guinevere has been revealed as the lover of Lancelot, and she has fled in shame to a nunnery. And Arthur comes after her, and she is so overwhelmed at his presence. She's literally on her knees, reaching to kiss the hem of his robe and begging for his forgiveness. And Arthur stands there and tells her that she doesn't have to beg. He forgives her, but he will never set eyes on her again, and she will never be permitted into his presence. He is maintaining the standards of the good Victorian. In Christian charity and love, he has forgiven her, but he is also completely unforgiving towards her. And this was the attitude of the Victorians towards the straying wife that Tennyson has him displaying in his poem. Tennyson does something else as well. He creates a response to the anxiety about evolution that was in the air for the Victorians. Darwin in 1859 published Origin of Species, and the concern was, where do humans fit? Are they evolving ever upwards, or are they degenerating and going into the abyss? In Tennyson's Idylls of the King, there's a repeated line, "The old order changeth, yielding place to new, and God fulfills himself in many ways, lest one good custom should corrupt the world." In all of the Arthurian stories, the end point is the final battle between Arthur and his treacherous nephew, Mordred. In some of the stories, Arthur dies. In others, he's taken away to be healed. But in Tennyson, there's the explicit idea that Arthur, taken away and returning, will return as a higher level of human being. He is part of the cycle of evolution, moving ever upwards. And this is Tennyson's response to Darwin in this poem. And artists as well responded to the reprinting of Malory and to Tennyson's Idylls of the King. So we have the Pre-Raphaelite Brotherhood in the 19th century being inspired by Arthurian ideas and stories to paint their famous images, highly detailed, highly colored representations of Arthurian tales. And some of the Pre-Raphaelite painters were poets themselves, such as Dante Gabriel Rossetti and William Morris. So they, in turn, are writing poetry that they are painting about, and so one inspires the other. And then, in the United States, Mark Twain took the story of Malory and gave it a satiric twist in Connecticut Yankee in King Arthur's Court. He made fun of the notion that the past was better and that Arthur's court was the image of perfection. And instead, his Connecticut Yankee, who time travels because of a bonk on the head, discovers that he is more intelligent than the whole of the court put together. And he just takes over and organizes those Britons. For instance, introducing bicycles so that they can fight their tournaments on bicycles and not have those horses anymore. So it's a very entertaining take on the stories of King Arthur. The stories were retold throughout the 20th century. We have in Britain T.H. White imagining the boyhood of Arthur in The Sword and the Stone, and then reimagining all of Malory in his trilogy, The Once and Future King. And that inspired Lerner and Lowe for their blockbuster 1960 musical, Camelot. In an interview with Life magazine in 1963, after her husband's assassination, Jacqueline Kennedy said that Camelot had been his favorite musical. And every evening at home in the White House, they had listened to the soundtrack for some time. And in particular, these lines he found inspirational. "Don't let it be forgot that once there was a spot for one brief shining moment that was known as Camelot." And after that interview was published, Camelot became the shorthand for Kennedy's 1,000-day term in the White House. And then there's Arthur on film, Excalibur, Fisher King, First Knight, just a few examples of the hundreds of films produced throughout the 20th century, starting, in fact, in the silent era with the now lost Quest of the Holy Grail, and carrying on. And then, of course, there's Monty Python. And we can see with Monty Python that the tales continue to accumulate characters and events because there's no single canonical Arthur story. Every retelling adds something to it. So if you're familiar with Monty Python and the Holy Grail, you'll remember brave, 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 brave Sir Robin. Well, he's become just as much a part of the story now as Sir Gawain, or Sir Gareth, or Sir Mordred. So we'll return to the question now of why has Arthur remained so popular? What is his enduring appeal? Well, part of that appeal perhaps lies in the fact that he is infinitely adaptable. He could be described as Gumby with a sword. He's whatever people need him to be. If they need him to be the medieval king, or the French king, or the Victorian man, or the modern day man, there he is. Arthur fits every circumstance. But that can't be his only appeal, because if it were, we wouldn't recognize Arthur from one story to another. The Arthurian tales have been described as a golden thread running through English literature, almost from its beginning. But the thread is golden, we can see it. So what is it that holds these tales together and makes them recognizable to us from one era to the next? I'd suggest there are three factors at play. One is the notion of justice. Back to the round table. It's round, and that means that no one takes precedence there. Every one of the knights has the same status as every other. Some of the knights are kings in their own lands. In this painting, some of them are wearing crowns. But they're sitting at the round table beside dukes and barons, and even commoners whose heroic exploits have allowed them to rise to this place of honor. They all have the same influence, the same voice there. Arthur has nephews, Gawain, Mordred, Agravain, but they have the same status at the table as Sir Palamedes, a Muslim knight who enters into the fellowship. And they're not only just in their governance, but they're just in their behavior. The knights are sworn to defend the weak and the helpless, to bring justice to unjust situations. The knights have to defend women and widows and orphans. And they give up their own pleasures, their own security, and sometimes their own lives in order to attain justice. In a world where we often see justice lacking in so many situations, the model of King Arthur appeals to us at a deep level. And then two, secondly, we see Arthur as a rebel. Now that might be hard to swallow if you think of Arthur dressed in the borrowed robes and being the trotted out as the symbol of a legitimate king. But that's not who Arthur was. Arthur, from the beginning, was an outsider. He was born of an illicit relationship. Nobody wanted him to be king. Even his own foster brother tried to take credit for pulling the sword from the stone. When it was determined that he was the only one who could do it, and that he was to be the king, there was opposition from the establishment. And throughout his reign, Arthur and his men continue fighting against the established order. They are fighting against the forces of oppression that are on the outside of Camelot, the forces that are capturing damsels and putting them in locked towers, the forces that are killing good knights and hanging their bodies in the trees. Arthur is rebelling against a status quo that says evil is the norm. Arthur, the rebel, appeals to us at the level of wanting goodness to prevail in the world. It's what Tennyson calls the beast that surrounds us, and Arthur is fighting against that beast. And it's one of the ironies of the tale that Arthur is ultimately defeated, not by the evil outside, but by the evil within his own court. And finally, I'd suggest that Arthur appeals to us because he is an ideal. He's the archetype of human perfectibility. We cannot reach it, but we want to be able to. We want to believe that there could be an ideal king, an ideal hope of the world. And it's that hope on which we end the stories. In some of the stories, as I said, Arthur dies. But in my favorite versions, Arthur is mortally wounded, and three queens come who take him away in their ship to the Island of Apples, the Isle of Avalon, where he will be healed. And Arthur does not die. Arthur is the once and future king. He does not die. He will not die as long as there are people who desire justice and truth, who rebel against the evil in established orders, and who long for an ideal that will be with them. Throughout the strange and magnificent stories of Arthur, spanning the globe and time, we cling to this hope that we have through the stories we tell. Thank you very much. Well, you know, I did. It had very poor reviews. I like Clive Owen. But I also liked the idea that it was set in that historical period and had some historical elements that I enjoyed. It's every version of the stories on film adds something to it. I like the seriousness of it as well. Other questions? No, I haven't. No. Have you?
No, but I'm going to.
Like, have you noticed, I guess, superheroes and heroes and ideals are popular now, the Marvel universe, but have you noticed, parallels with, Thor and the inability for anyone else to lift the hammer, and him as an ideal, but only he can lift the hammer, so to speak? Do you think, the origin of Arthur could have been rooted in?
Absolutely. That's absolutely a possibility. The folklorist Joseph Campbell identified the hero motif that runs worldwide and has the consistent elements of the birth in obscurity and the arrival of the hero into a situation and his development into his powers, his battles. And we see this pattern through all of the hero tales. So the Nordic association is completely possible, that it might have been the Saxons and the Angles who brought over stories that were adapted into Arthur stories as well. Yeah, good question. Any other questions?
Come and take him to the Isle of Avalon, and he doesn't die.
Yeah.
Of course, that to me evokes connections to Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so. Arthur is in Christian theology, he's a type of Christ, a figure of Christ, a precursor or a model. The painting that was up here earlier is of the three queens. And we've got the three queens there around him, and he's going to be carried off by them. Any questions?
It's been a long time since I've read, I remember reading Steinbeck's, you have cover art for that book, and I also read Mists of Avalon. And I forget which one, but one of the, I think it must have been Mists of Avalon, they made the connection that Excalibur, the sword, was forged from an iron meteorite.
Oh, yes.
It was like it was a divine authority.
Sure.
Do you remember it?
Yeah, I think that's in Marion Zimmer Bradley. Steinbeck stayed much closer to Mallory in his version. And in fact, Steinbeck's version wasn't finished. It was published unfinished at his death. But Marion Zimmer Bradley has some very imaginative elements. And I think that meteorite as the sword is part of what she does. And that's another example of the tales accumulating elements. Just talking about Excalibur could fill an entire lecture because there's so many aspects of that. Jack White. Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I imagine that, in fact, the meteor, the iron swords is not a complete fiction. King Tut's knife has been ascertained to be meteoritic iron.
Huh. Very interesting. Thank you. Any comments? Oh. Thank you very much for your attention. I believe we have coffee and snacks outside, and I hope to see you here for February 24th for my colleague, Dr. Hugh Gordon's lecture. Thank you.